1 Thessalonians 4:17. Then put a bookmark there and go over to Acts 1:9. Amen. I told you we'll be working out this morning. We need to learn these things. These things are good for us so that we can have a healthy understanding of the Word of God. If you have Exodus 19, I want you to begin reading verse 1. What does the Bible say? Exodus 19:1, what does the Bible say?
It says, "And the third month, on the same day of the month, that the Israelites had left the land of Egypt, they entered the wilderness of Sinai. After they departed from Rephidim, they entered the wilderness of Sinai and camped in the wilderness of Israel, camped there in front of the mountain."
Now understand, God leads Israel by day, by what? Anybody remember? He was cloud. He was leading the people of God by a cloud. But then he becomes a pillar of fire at night. And so God's presence was represented by a cloud. When the Lord met with Moses and Aaron at the tabernacle, the Lord would come down in a cloud, and the people could not come towards the tabernacle because the Bible says the cloud enveloped the entire tabernacle. It was God's Shekinah glory. The word Shekinah literally means God's dwelling glory. And so when God comes, he's pictured as coming in a cloud. But there are other times when God will judge. The Bible speaks about God judging Egypt and punishing Egypt. It says he will come on a quick cloud. So the cloud can represent God's majesty, but the cloud can also represent God's judgment. Those are two terms that God will use oftentimes to describe two things, his majesty and his judgment. Amen? Now, 1 Thessalonians 4:17, what does the Bible say? 1 Thessalonians 4:17. We want to see another example of God's usage of this term, clouds. Amen? Yes, sir. What does the Bible say?
It says, "Then we who are still alive will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord."
Do you see that? We're going to meet the Lord in the clouds. Now look at Acts 1, around verse 9. What does the Bible say there? The
Bible says, "After he had said this, he was taken up as they were watching, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, there was gazing into heaven, and suddenly two men in white clothes stood by them. They said, 'Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up into the heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way that you have seen him going into heaven.'"
Amen, amen. So we know that the Lord will leave on the cloud and he'll come back on the cloud. And let me give you some good hope. The Lord will never set his foot on earth again. The Lord will never set foot on this earth again.
All right.
Now I know there's some people that are called premillennialists, or premillennialists rather, and they believe that the Lord will come back and he will reign for 1,000 years. He will set up his kingdom in Jerusalem. And that's why you hear a lot of preachers on TV preaching that false doctrine. Because they don't understand the symbology of the scriptures. They take something and then they make it literal, which is actually figurative. Then they take something figurative, amen, and they make it literal. Now, we have time to get into that, but I just want you to know that's false teaching. We will deal with that because I want to talk about this thing called the rapture. We'll talk about that. But I want you to get, this is a good precursor to that. This is a good beginning point to that. Now look at verse 15. "Now that we see the vision of the ancients of days, Now we're going to see the next thing, the vision of the ultimate victory. The vision of the ultimate victory. Look at verse 15. I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit in the midst of my body, and the visions of my head troubled me. I came near unto one of them that stood by. He's referring to the angelic beings more than likely, and asked him the truth of all this. So he told me and made me know the interpretation of these things. These great beasts, which are four, are four kings which shall arise out of the earth. We talked about the kings. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast, which was diverse from all the others, exceeding dreadful, whose teeth were of iron, and his nails of brass, which devoured, break in pieces, and stamped the residue with his feet. And of the ten horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, and before whom three fell, even of that horn that had eyes and a mouth that spoke very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows. Verse 21 says, I beheld the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them. Now, if you understand again that this is a vision, you will have to understand that Daniel is predicting what's going to happen in the fourth kingdom. The fourth kingdom is the Roman Empire. Rome defeated the Grecian Empire, and their footprint lasted for over 1,400 years. They stretched as far as Europe, all the way down to Africa, even toward India. They were the largest empire in the world at that time. God brought all this to completion in terms of the visions in the book, really in the person of the Roman Empire. He allowed unity in the world. He allowed one language. And it's interesting that Paul, or rather Daniel, writes the book of Daniel from chapters 1 to chapter 7. He's really speaking about a historical narrative, what happened to him and his fellow Judaizers, not Judaizers, but Jews, people of Judah, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But then he goes from chapters 8 all the way to chapter 12, and he uses Hebrew. And the reason why he uses Aramaic from chapter 1 to 7 is because Aramaic was what they call the lingua franca. That's the language of the world at that time. But you're going to find out from chapters 8 to 12, he's going to switch to Hebrew. Because now he's dealing with Israel's future. Okay? That's just kind of a jump start for next week. Amen. So understand this. Now there is a fourth kingdom. It's a terrible kingdom. It means the vision is so terrible because Rome will dominate. Now in Greece, in terms of Greece, Greece had a culture. They had more of a desire to bring people up and uplift through arts and through philosophy. But Rome was more imperialistic. Rome did not care about arts. Rome only cared about taking you by force. And so they were pictured as being terrible. They killed and slaughtered millions. And so now the vision is coming to a close. We're looking at what God is going to do. The Lord is going to destroy all those kingdoms. And he's going to do it not in a physical manner, but in a spiritual manner. You recall his disciples were always asking, he says, Lord, when will God restore Israel back? They thought he was going to restore them in a physical sense. They thought that God was going to restore Israel back to his former glory. But the Lord was not looking for a restoration in a physical sense. The Lord was always looking at restoration from a spiritual sense. Amen. And so the rock represented the power of God, the rock that was hewn without hands, that struck the feet and destroyed all those kingdoms. Now that's symbolic. Because over there in Matthew chapter 16, around verse 18, the Bible says what? Upon what? Oh, y'all with me this morning? Come on now. Upon what? I know you know the verse. Upon this rock, I shall build what? My church. And what will happen? And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Amen. I'm preaching better than y'all speaking. Praise the Lord. I know y'all might be sick, but look here, I'm tired, and y'all come on with me still. Amen. And so we understand there is a vision. God says, I'm going to fulfill this vision even in the times of the Gentiles. Luke chapter, I believe it is chapter 21, around verse 24. The Bible talks about the times of the Gentiles. It's a time that the four kingdoms will be dominant. So you see that in Luke chapter 21, verse 24. It talks about the times of the Gentiles. That's the time of Gentile domination in the world. So now we're going to see what God is going to do finally. Look at verse 21. And I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them, until the angels of days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. Verse 23. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread down and break in pieces. The ten horns out of the kingdom are ten kings that shall arise. Another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue three kings. He shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change the times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until end of time, a time and times, and the dividing of time. Now, this is an Aramaic phrase, the times and time and half. What he's saying is, there's going to be a span of about 3.5 years. I don't have time to get into it, but you'll see this in the book of Revelation. You'll call it 1260 days. This is a 3.5 year period. God is so particular and God is so specific, he doesn't leave any doubt what's going to happen. Amen. And then watch this in verse 26. But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and to destroy it until the end. Now, brothers and sisters, understand this. God is giving us the victory already. That's why we don't have to worry about what's going to happen. Because God has already fixed the fight. Praise the Lord. Give me Matthew chapter 24. God has already fixed the fight. In other words, when you read scripture, understand this. It may look like the world is winning and we're being dominated by evil. But God has already told us we have the victory. He's just working out your soul salvation. Those of us who are members of the body of Christ, we're already saved. All we got to do is keep on walking. The Bible has said we have the victory. Look at verse 27. And stay right there in Matthew 24. We're going to read that in just a second. And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. Do you see that? The Bible says, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominion shall serve and obey him. Hitherto is the end of the matter. As for Daniel, my cogitations and my thoughts much troubled me, and my countenance changed in me, but I kept the matter in my heart. Brothers and sisters, this is connected to what we would call the desolation of abomination. In Matthew chapter 24, there is an experience that the Lord has with his disciples. And they asked him, they said, Master, tell us when the end will come. And many have really misconstrued this particular pericope, because they believe this is the first half anyway, is talking about the destruction of the world. But sometimes when the Bible says the end of the world, he's not talking about the physical world. He's talking about a certain period of time. There's a Greek word called ion, of the age. That's really a better way of saying it. Now I want us to begin looking at verse 24. Begin reading at verse number 1. Yes, sir.
As Jesus left and was going out of the temple complex, his disciples came up and called his attention to the temple building. Then he replied to them, "Don't you see all these things? I assure you, not one stone will be left here on another that will not be thrown down."
Yes, sir.
While he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples approached him privately and said, "Tell us, when will these things happen? And what is the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?"
Now watch this now, watch this. His disciples want to know, just like we want to know. When is it time to get right? When can I stop sinning? So I can make sure when you come, I'll be ready to go to heaven. Amen. Amen. They weren't done with that. Amen. If you knew when Jesus was coming, how many of us would stay on the right track? Amen. But watch what the Lord says. Keep reading.
Verse 4.
Yeah.
Then Jesus replied to them, "Watch out that no one deceive you."
Now watch this. The Lord says, "Be careful." Some folks are going to try to trick you.
"For many will come in my name saying."
Many will come into his name saying.
"I am the Messiah."
I am the Messiah. Now, in history, there were men during the time of Christ that said, "I am Jesus." The one you're reading about, I'm the one. During the time of Jesus, there was an incident where there was a man who led thousands away into the wilderness, and they were ultimately killed. And this is why when Pontius finally had Jesus in his midst, he said, "Now, are you the Jesus?" Because there's a lot of folks claiming to be Jesus around here. He said, "Now, you say so." He said, "I am him. I am the Jesus." And you know, we laugh about that. That's why they get fooled. Well, people get fooled today.
Amen.
Every time you turn the TV on, you know, "I'm a prophet." Yeah, they got more prophets and apostles nowadays than you can shake a stick at. Apostle J.J. Jackson, prophetess Samantha Smith. Everybody said, "Man, ain't that many prophets and apostles in the Bible?" But people are deceived. People will watch them. People will send their money to them. And then they'll fuss when they come in. And I ask you, "Hey, can you give?" "You give no money to that church?" "And you done paid $20 for some crystal oil. And some toilet water." Tell me they got it from Jerusalem, Alabama, baby. That's fine. You're being deceived. The Lord said, "Don't be deceived. Many will come in my name." Keep reading. What else is left?
"And they will deceive many."
Yeah.
Verse 6 says, "You are going to hear of wars and rumors of war."
Now watch this. Now here's the thing, brothers and sisters. Even with us, we have to be careful. The text says, "You will hear rumors of wars." And you know what we do? Yeah, you know there's a war in Iraq right now. Jesus coming back. Oh, you know, Afghanistan, we got a war over there. Jesus coming back. You know, I heard we're about to go to war with Russia. You better get right. Now understand this. Jesus is contextualizing this. He's saying this will be in your time period. This won't happen some 2017 years later. This is going to happen. What he's talking about now is going to happen now. In a short period of time, I should say. All right? Keep that in mind. Keep reading.
"See that you are not alone, because these things must take place.
Yeah.
But the end is not yet.
It's not yet.
For nation will rise up against nation and kingdom against kingdom.
Yeah.
There will be famine and earthquakes in various places."
Oh, we got earthquakes over there in India. They had an earthquake in California last week. This is coming back. Don't be fooled.
"All these events are the beginning of birth pains."
Yeah. In other words, the Lord says all these things are going to happen, and they happen during the time of the apostolic age. Amen. I'm trying to help you now. I know this is not the most exciting lesson, but this is an educational lesson. Amen. And you got to know this because you can get fooled. You can get fooled. Now keep reading.
Then they will hand you over for persecution, mm-hmm. and they will kill you. Mm-hmm. You will be hated by all nations because of my name. Mm-hmm. Then many will take offense, betray one another, and hate one another. Many false prophets will rise up and deceive many, because lawlessness will multiply, the love of many will grow cold.
Go right there. Now, this is an interesting set of passages here. Jesus is saying, be careful because you will be deceived in this last period of time. Christians that were faithful will then begin to fall away because they'll lose their faith. And I find it so analogous to our day. You can't watch social media without people questioning, well, you know, I'm tired of being Christian, man. It just seems like I don't know if Jesus really existed. I've had more people ask me, I had a brother, I told you this a couple weeks ago. Brother asked me the other day, he said, was Jesus really alive? Everybody talking about Osiris and Imhotep and all these other, you know, African religions. And I help people. Now, that's why you don't see a lot of young people in church today. Our young people are being fooled, being told lies about mythical African spiritual religions. As a matter of fact, they call them mystery religions because they were not even believed even during that time. These are mystical things. But Satan doesn't care how you get your faith. He just wants it.
All right.
Satan will tell you to worship a chicken and give the Israel food. Praise the Lord. He doesn't care what he does. Satan does not fight fair. The Bible says he's like a lion, seeking whom he may devour. What we got to do, brothers and sisters, is get in this word. And when you don't come back, when you don't study during the week, and then you come here on Sunday, you want to get a fill up, and then you leave out here, you don't even study what I just talked about, and then you have problems on the job, problems in your family, and you're ready to leave the church. Amen. You know why? Because you're not kind of hand. Our is not going to help. It's going to help jumpstart you, but you got to keep on. This is the battery, not the alternator, praise the Lord. You got to keep on after you leave here. And I'm saying this out of love because I feel like the church is waning. I feel like a lot of us are teetering on unbelief. And the more we stay away from the word of God, the easier it is for Satan to snatch us up. And I pledge, not on my watch, whether it's 10 people here or 10,000, it doesn't matter. The word of God is going to be preached.
Amen.
Keep reading. We're almost done. I'm going to get y'all here just
But the one who endures to the end will be delivered. This good news of the kingdom will be proclaimed in all the world as a testimony to all nations.
Hold that right there. There's a religious belief that once saved, always saved. They say that God is not an Indian giver. If God gave you salvation, God will never snatch it back. And I totally agree with that, believe it or not. I believe God will give you salvation based upon the prerequisites of the gospel, and he won't take it away. But you can believe that. So you have security as long as you stay in the fold.
Amen.
What we do then is we sin, and by sinning we leave the fold.
Amen.
And you're not protected by the shepherd anymore. Sin has separated you. You remember that, we talked about that, right? Your sins have made God's ear heavy. So you and God are in relationship as long as you stay in the faith. But the minute you leave the faith, you have forfeited your salvation. So you are saved eternally as long as you stay in the faith.
Amen.
But here's what the Bible says here. He says, but those who endure. That word's in the aorist tense. The word endure means that as long as you have kept your faith from the time you had it, and you keep it even to this time, God will save you. But it's not a guarantee. You know why? Because some didn't endure. Some didn't want to keep on walking because it got too hard for them. And that's the same thing that's happening in our world today. Keep reading.
And the end will come. So when you see the abomination that causes desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel,
we just talked about it,
standing in the holy place, Let the reader understand.
Yeah, yeah.
Then those in Judea must flee to the mountains.
Yeah.
The man on the hills, on the housetop, must not come down to get things out of his house.
Now think about this. Think about this. If this is the end of the world, like some of what they call futurists believe, if this is the end of the world, what good is going to the top of your house and standing there going to do? Huh? Well, what good is going to the mountains going to come? You know, as a matter of fact, the Bible says the people are going to say, hide me, mountains, hide me, hills, yeah, when the Lord comes back. So this is not talking about the end of the world. This is talking about the end of an age, the end of an era, the end of Judea, Jerusalem, the city, and the end of Jews in terms of a physical people. This is what it's talking about. Keep reading.
And a man in the field must not go back to get his clothing.
Yeah.
Woe to the pregnant woman and nursing mother in those days.
So what good is that? If you're pregnant and nursing, why is he telling you woe if this is the end of the world?
That's right.
Amen. Because you got, what God is trying to tell these Christians is that you got to get out of Jerusalem before the gates close. The gates would close, and those who were captured in the city would die because Titus, as history tells us, Titus besieged and sacked Jerusalem in AD 70. And the amazing fact, according to world literature, is that when Titus came and seized Jerusalem, no Christian died. About 1.2 million people were either killed or captured, and not one Christian died. The ones that were captured and killed were Jews. If they had listened to the word of God, they would have escaped physically. And if they obeyed the word of God, they would have been saved spiritually.
Amen.
Isn't that something? That's irony right there, y'all. Keep reading. We almost
finished. For at that time there will be great tribulation.